Hello, I'm Reverend Sam. I'm your host on this Secret of Glory and Power. I believe that everyone that is created to this world is created with an anointing, a special gifting, a special power. I remember a particular woman in Lagos, Nigeria. This woman is from all those, this tribe among the, I've forgotten their tribe now. But she has this, I don't know how to call it. When people have broken bones, this woman will use some kind of ointment and will be helping them to straighten their bones. The person is from Ekpa area. She's a woman. Now, what she uses is ori, all this, kind of oil. And these people's leg will be healed. That's divine ability. Some people are gifted with understanding the power of leaves. The different leaves and the kind of medicinal value that they have. Because you see, God give us these leaves so that these leaves can help to nourish and sustain our body. What do I mean? Our body was made from the dust. All the grasses grow from the dust. And that is why they are useful to help our body to be healed. Some people have special ability to be able to know the kind of leaves that you put together, you rub, you squeeze, and then they put it upon a particular area of your body and they'll be healing. I even know that some people, especially in the ancient times, they know the kind of leaves to get. They will squeeze it with their mouth, especially when somebody has a snake bite, and they will put it on top of that place and the poison will come out. All these things are what I call special power that God gives to each of us. You may be watching me right now. You may not even be a person that has the gift of God upon your life, like maybe you have the calling, but you are gifted in seeing things. You discover that anytime a thought is predominant in your heart, that thing will come to pass. That's a gifting from God. But the problem is, are you profiting for God with that gifting? Because the purpose why God gives us every gift is so that we can make profit with it. So the purpose of this telecast, this program, is to open the eyes of your understanding to the secret that can help that gift, that glory, that power that is in you, that can help it to come out. Both for the blessings of the people around you, for the blessings of the church of God, and also for that gifting to be able to also give you a means of sustenance. Because when Jesus gave the 5 talents, he said, go and profit with it. The one that has 2 went to go and trade and brought back 2 talents. The one that had 5 went to go and trade and bring back 5 talents. When Jesus was a young man and his mother, they thought he was lost. But when they found him, he said, don't you know I must go about my father's business? That means Jesus saw the preaching of the gospel as God's business. And so he used the anointing God has given to him to do God's business. The truth is, everything that God has given to us is meant to profit. Even in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Bible said the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with it. When they say profit, it doesn't mean that you now begin to charge people and then begin to amass money to your pocket. No. What it means is that you get result for God. You allow your gifting to draw men to God. Do you know that if you are specially gifted in, maybe you have knowledge of herbs, you can use it in the church. People, instead of going to pay for surgery that does not work, they can get to understanding. Maybe you have to charge a minimal amount, of course, to cover the cost and make profit so that you too can be able to sustain the business and pay your expenses. But what I'm saying is this. Many of us have gifts, but for whatever reason, we are still struggling. We are not successful financially, and that grieves the heart of God. Because God said gold and silver, they are mine. And that's why this program is meant to challenge you. To challenge you and challenge that uniqueness in you, that divine ability in you, so that you can begin to profit for God. You can begin to use your gifting to bring men to God. The Bible says that by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, when you have love one for another. And how do we express love? You give what people need today. You don't just pray for them. You seek for how to use what you have to help them to get what they need. That's why this program is established. But today I want to speak to us about one of the sons of Jacob. His name is Judah. You know, Jesus said, do unto others what we want men to do unto you. This man, Judah, he betrayed a covenant. And at the end of the day, it backfired on him. You know, many of us that are watching me right now, it's possible that one of the reasons why you are suffering and no prayer can solve your problem is because of what I want to talk about today. Because you see, the Bible says that when you confess your sins, then you will be forgiven and then you will be healed. Healing doesn't come before confession and forgiveness. And many of you have done this against other people, and in their heart, they are not happy. They have called God on your behalf. Maybe they don't even believe in God. They have gone to call Satan on your behalf. And because they have a reason to hold you bound, that's why you are still under satanic bondage. The Bible says a curse that has no reason cannot stand. Curseless curse cannot stand. That's what the Bible says. So if someone has cursed you, but they have a ground of what you have done that make them to curse you, that curse will stand until and except you know what you have done, you make restitution, and then you pray for healings. Let's go ahead and look at the life of this man, Judah. I read from Genesis chapter 38. We are told that it happened at that time that Judah went down with it from his brothers and turned aside to a certain Adullamite, whose name was Hiram. There Judah saw a daughter of a certain Canaanite whose name was Shua. He took her and went in unto her. That means he married her and slept with her. And she conceived and bare a son, and he called the name of that son Er. She conceived again and bore a son, and she called his name Onan. Yet again she bore a son, and she called the name of that one Shelah. Judah was in Shezit when she bore him. Now, after a process of time, many years had gone by, the children have grown. Verse 6, the Bible says, and Judah took a wife for Er, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. It is Tamar and Judah that we want us to consider today. Now, the Bible says, but Er, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord put him to death. Verse 8, then Judah said to Onan, that is the second son, go into your brother's wife and perform the duty of a brother-in-law to her and raise up offspring for your brother. Don't ask me questions about that. It is their custom. Even now, right now, in some part of Africa, you know, when a man dies, it is the next person to the man that died that will now adopt the wife that one left. It's a tradition. It has nothing to do with religion. So don't ask questions about that. But that was what happened here. When Er died, the father, Judah, called Onan. He said, go into your brother's wife and raise offspring. In other words, make her to conceive and make her to bring children. Children that will be bearing your brother's name. But look at what the second son did. But Onan knew that the offspring would not be his. So whenever he went in unto his brother's wife, he will waste the semen on the ground so as not to give offspring to his brother. When he knows that he's not going to allow the woman to be pregnant through him, why did he agree? I mean, if you are not going to agree to something, don't agree to it. Whatever you agree to, make sure you keep your part of the agreement. The father told him, go into your brother's wife, sleep with her, make sure she conceive and give birth to children that are going to belong to your brother. When Onan knows that he's not ready to do it, if he would have told his father, he didn't tell his father. Wicked man, he will go in unto the woman, he will sleep with her. When it is time for her now to release, he will release on the floor. And he kept on doing that. And the Bible said that thing made God to be angry. Look at it. Verse 10 now. And what he did was wicked in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord put him to death also. God killed him because of that. Remember, I said in the beginning of this telecast that Jesus said, do unto others what we want men to do unto you. One of the reasons why we have so much imperfection and confusion in our world is because people are doing things to others that they never dreamed should be done to them. Will Onan be happy if he was the one that died, if his junior brother now did that to his wife? Of course he will not be happy, and yet he's doing the same thing to another person. And that's why we have so much injustice in the church. That's why we have so much sickness among us as believers, because we are not loving each other genuinely. We are destroying each other at our back. We speak to each other, we smile to each other, but inside us, we are not wishing ourselves well. And when you do that, the judgment of God will come against you. Whether you are a pastor, whether you are not a Christian, doesn't matter. The judgment of God will come against you. It is the law of life that whatever you sow is what you will reap. If you sow wickedness, you will reap wickedness. If you sow love and mercy, you will reap love and mercy. Let's go ahead. Then Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, "Remain a widow in your father's house until Shelah, my son, grows up, for he feared that he will die like his brothers." So Tamar went and remained in her father's house. Can you imagine how many years? He was married to the first boy. That one died. Then the second son just used her and dumped her. And Judah said to himself, maybe it is this woman that has bad leg. That's what we call it in Africa. Because if not, how will my first son die married to him? Married to her, sorry. And now my second son also died married to her. Then there must be an evil, there must be a spell that is pursuing this woman. There must be an evil thing that is going with this woman. Now, Judah did not make effort to go to the prophet to go and find out what is happening in my household. Why are my sons dying? He just concluded. Maybe you have done the same thing too. I know a part in Nigeria where they do that also. They will victimize the woman. They will dehumanize her because her husband died. And that's what Judah did here. Judah did not say it to the woman. He pretended as if he cared. He said, "You know what? Tamar, I want you to go to your father's house and remain as a widow there. When my last born grows up, then you come back and marry him." But the Bible said that he feared that he would die like his brother. So he was lying. Now, verse 12. In the course of time, the wife of Judah, Shua's daughter, died. When Judah was comforted, he went up to Timnah, to his sheep shearer, he and his friends, Hira the Adullamite. And when Tamar was told, "Your father-in-law is going up to Timnah to shear his sheep," he took off her widow's garment and covered herself with a veil, wrapping herself up, and sat at the entrance to Enaim, which is on the road to Timnah. What did the lady did? The lady, with time, discovered that Judah only deceived her. And you see, the tradition is so strong that nobody will marry that woman. So the woman was just useless in her father's house. She's growing older, no hope of having children. And then maybe that youngest boy, maybe he has also heard that boy has gotten married. You know what the woman now did? The woman now decided, when he now heard that his father-in-law was going somewhere, and in those days there's a way, a prostitute, there's a way they dress and they stand by the roadside. So he knew that his father-in-law's wife has died. So he knew that his father-in-law would be looking for a woman to spend some time with. So he now pretended to be a harlot, sitting along the roadside. For she knew that Shelah was grown up and she had not been given to him in marriage. You see what I'm saying now? When Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute, for she had covered her face. He turned to her at the roadside and said, "Come, let me come into you. You know, let me sleep with you this night." For he did not know that she was his daughter-in-law. She said, "What will you give me that you may come in unto me?" And he answered, "I will send you a young goat from the flock." And she said, "If you give me a pledge," in other words, if you give me a deposit, like a promissory note, "then until you send it." Then he said, "What pledge shall I give to you?" She replied, "Your signet, your cord, and your staff that is in your hand. And in case you don't know, those things that that lady asked for, they are very peculiar to everybody. So Judah will know his own rod. There's a way you cannot mistake a Judah's rod. They always have a particular sign on each person's rod. And so he gave them to her and went in unto her, and she conceived by him. Then she arose and went away, taking off her veil. She put on the garment of her widowhood. Now, when Judah sent the young goat by his friend the Adullamite to take back the pledge from the woman's hand, he did not find her. And he asked the men of the place, "Where is the cult prostitute who was at Enin at the roadside?" And they said, "No cult prostitute has been here." So he returned to Judah and said, "I have not found her." Wow, I sense a strong anointing right now. And also, the men of the place said, "No cult prostitute has been here." And Judah replied, "Let her keep the things as her own, or shall we be laughed at now? You see, I sent him a young goat and we did not find her." About 3 months later, Judah was told, "Tamar, your daughter-in-law, has been immoral. Moreover, she is pregnant by immorality." And Judah said, "Bring her out and let her be burnt." The boy that he promised her is now grown up. That boy has been allowed to marry another woman. This woman is still staying in her father's house. When the woman now used corny method to make sure that his father-in-law slept with him, let us say what she did was wrong, but you know when somebody is desperate, they can do anything. But I want us to look at the life of Judah, because Judah did not keep his word. We are not living in a perfect world. I am not exonerating that man. But what I'm saying is, let's look at Judah. Judah promised the woman that I'm going to give you my son when he grows up. In the process of time, the boy grows up, gets married, and this woman was left alone. And when the woman now gets pregnant by her father-in-law, now, as she was being brought out, she sent a word to her father-in-law, "By the man to whom this belonged, I was pregnant." And she said, "Please identify who these are, and the signet, and the cord, and the staff." Then Judah identified them and said, "She is more righteous than I, since I did not give her my son Shelah," and he did not know her again. In other words, he didn't sleep with her again, but it became a public ridicule. It became a public ridicule. It became a snare, like a negative sign, a negative mark against Judah. Now, let me ask you this question. Who caused this problem? Of course, it's Judah. Number one, when something bad happens, don't let us just take irrational decisions. Don't let us take irrational conclusions. Don't let us make assumptions. Spend time to wait upon the Lord. Fast, pray, seek the face of God to find out what is wrong. Why are things going the way they are going? There should be an answer to every question. And from the way we looked at this man, Judah, he did not treat that woman as if it's her own daughter. If it's her own daughter, how would she have felt? Maybe you are watching me right now, and you also have been mischievous against your daughter's husband. Because that's what I see right now. Someone is watching me, you have been mischievous against your daughter's husband. You have deceived him. And the Lord is asking me to tell you, you have to call that young man. You have to tell him what you have done. You have to apologize to him. And then I now see that after you have done that, I see something that looks like a spiritual mark, like a sneer, like an evil curse. I see it lifted after you have done it. Because I see that your daughter's husband, you have done something against him by deceit. And God is angry. Because the young man is also grieving his heart. And God asked me to tell you that you have to call the person. You have to apologize to him. Explain what you have done. If possible, ask him to pray for you. And then I see that I see like a mark taking off from you. Maybe things are already going bad, and you have been asking yourself, what is wrong with me? What is wrong with my family? What is wrong with my marriage? Do you know that when Abimelech took Sarah, the wife of Abraham, the Bible says, every woman that is under Abimelech inside his palace, all of them suddenly became barren. Why? Because he took Sarah to be his wife. Of course, we can't blame Abimelech because Abraham did not tell him that it is his wife. But despite the fact that Abraham did not tell him that it is his wife, God was still angry and God was still ready to place a curse on Abimelech because of that. Many of you are watching me that the affliction you are going through, the suffering you are going through right now, it is as a result of some mischievous thing that you have done in the past. And God is asking me to tell you that you need to go and repent. You need to call that person and confess to them and apologize. And I pray that in the name of Jesus, as you call them to apologize, I pray God will grant them the grace to forgive you. Because only then and after then, Can the yoke upon your own life be lifted and the blessings of God will come upon you. Hallelujah. And you are watching me. Some people have done things against you and you know it. And your heart has not forgiven them. Do you know that unforgiveness is as a sin of witchcraft? Do you know that because of unforgiveness, you can go to hellfire? Do you know that if you don't forgive those who offend you, your heavenly Father will not forgive your own offense? Do you know that if your Father does not forgive your offense, that means your prayer will not be heard? I mean, you just have to understand. We are living in an imperfect world. Different people do different things which they are not supposed to do, I know. But one thing I decided in myself is that as much as it lies with me, I will live at peace with all men. Does that mean everybody will be peaceful with me? No. But I will do my best to live at peace with all men. If I find out that you are not ready to accept my peace, Jesus said, if you go to preach the gospel and then the people do not accept you, take your shoe, dust it off and move to another place. If I am peaceful with you, if I am making effort to be at peace with you, and I find out that you are not ready to embrace the peace and be peaceful with me, I'm not going to pick offense. I'm just going to walk away. It's better for me to walk away than to pick offense. And so you are watching me. People have offended you. It's time to forgive them. It's time to forgive them. Because Yoruba has a proverb. If you keep retaliating for every evil people have done, you also find out that you'll be guilty of the evil you are trying to retaliate one way or the other. So why don't you just let it go? Let God vindicate you. Let God fight for you. Forgive them so that your Heavenly Father can forgive your own offenses too. Do you remember Job? His friends were wrongly accusing him. And the Bible tells me that he was hurt in his heart and he did not know that God was not happy with that attitude. But the Bible tells me that God told Job that he should pray for his friends. And the Bible says that God turned around the captivity of Job after he had prayed for his friends. You need to know that you have to pray for those who offend you. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says that you have to bless those who despitefully persecute you. I know it's not easy. But that is the way you prove to the devil that you are qualified for the blessing that is coming your way. Judas sneered his image by this art. He would have found out what his children are doing wrong, but he did not. Instead of that, what he did was he assumed that it must be the lady that has problem. But we know from the record now that it was his children that are wicked before God. I therefore pray for you that in the name of Jesus, that the hands of mercy will reach out to you. The hand of God's mercy. The hands of God's mercy. I pray it will reach out to you. I pray that in every way and in any way that you have erred, you have gone the wrong way, you have done the wrong thing. I pray that in the name of Jesus, the mercy of God will reach out to you. That the Lord God will help you to remember what you have done wrong. You will dream that in your dream. The thought will come back to you. And I pray for grace for you to be able to take the right step, corrective steps, in the name of Jesus. Because the Bible says, do to others what you want men to do unto you. I pray for grace for you. The grace that will make you to be a light to your world, an example to the people of this world, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Before I go, I have this special announcement I want to give to you. I want to specially invite you to my birthday. It's coming up on December 22nd, this month of December. It's a Saturday, 22nd of December. I'm inviting you to my birthday and official dedication of our church hall. Because after my birthday, we're going to start church. And if you are watching me out there and you are not committed to any church, why don't you join us? Let's do the work of God together. You can see from the way I've been talking and the way I've been on air that my passion is to reach out to lives. You can join me to get it sorted. You can join me to get it done. And you know by the mercy of God that I teach God's word with practical realities. So if you are someone that is hungry for God and you want to know how to walk with God and walk in the word of God, then Living Witness Assembly should be the place where you worship. Because there we teach you the truth of God's word. But you see, this 22nd of December, I'm especially inviting you. And God told me that he wants to give some people gifts, just like Herod did his birthday. And when the daughter danced and it pleased him, he told that daughter and said, "Ask me anything you need, up to half of my kingdom, I will give it to you because you have pleased me." And the Bible says that though the girl asked for the head of John the Baptist, even though the king was not happy about the request that the girl made, but the king gave to her the head of John the Baptist. God said to me that he's going to make new covenant with you that day. Mark it in your calendar. It's a Saturday, so the program starts by 4 p.m. The address of the venue is 11214. Suite D. D for dog. D for daughter. Plainfield Road by West Belfort. I will say it again. 11214D Plainfield Road by West Belfort. I want you to make effort to be there, because I believe that as you come and you celebrate the grace of God on my life, and you just come and say, "You know what, Reverend Sam, we've been enjoying your program on TV. We just here to just celebrate with you." That one has nothing to do with church. That one is my birthday and the official dedication of our church hall. I invite you to be there. And I believe that as you come, God will give to you something you have been desiring to do for you for a long time. He told me that he will honor people that day. He will honor me by establishing new covenant with people that day. And I want you to be there. Now, do you also know that you can support our ministry financially? Maybe you are committed to your church, and I'm not asking anyone that is committed to their church to leave their church and come to our church. No, that's not the way church of God is supposed to be. Of course, God will sometimes send some people from one church to another because he wants to use them. That one is God sending people. The Holy Ghost can speak to someone and say, "You know what, I want you to go and join that man in his ministry," because God has ordained that he wants to use you in that place. That one is different. But I'm one of those pastors that will sweet talk and then draw people by deceit out of their church to come to another church. We are just wasting our time when we do that, because we are supposed to reach out to the world, not steal other church members. But you can be a part of those who help us succeed. Do you know that? You can support us financially to support our media ministries. No amount is too small and no amount is too big. Fingers are not equal, so everybody can do something. So if you feel that in your heart God is touching you to support us financially, just call the number on the screen, send me an email, send text message to the phone on the screen, and we'll get back to you. And for everyone who give us a gift, I'm going to give them this book that I titled Ancient Secrets That Guarantee Financial Abundance. Ancient Secrets That Guarantee Financial Abundance. I will send it to you anywhere in the United States of America. This book contains practical principles that will help you to make money, keep money, and multiply your money. And I know that as you join us as a covenant partner, the Lord God will arise on your behalf and will do you good in the name of Jesus. Don't forget, I'm specially inviting you to that program that day. The address is also on the screen. You will see the special invitation on the screen. Copy the address. If you don't know the address, you can text us and then we text you back the address. I've got to go right now. Until I come here again next time, don't you ever forget that you are created with glory and power. Don't die unfulfilled. God bless you. I'm Reverend Sal.